Welcome to Hydro Haven. In this episode, I'll show you how I set up my grow area. This will cover everything I have in place before I start the first seed. Probably not the most riveting content, but I think it'll serve as a good reference. If you would, go ahead and hit that like button. I really appreciate it, and I hope you find this information useful. For our grow rack, we'll be using a Trinity brand storage rack, 6 foot tall, 24 by 48 inches. I purchased this at the Home Depot. It is an NSF approved storage rack, meaning that this is safe for use in the food industry. Probably overkill for this application, but since I'm growing food, I always prefer to err on the side of caution. I also have a couple of 2x4s there. So the bottom shelf, even though the shelves are rated at, I think, at around 300 pounds, most of the weight will be in the center, so the bottom shelf will bow a little bit, and that will be used to support so it doesn't bend over time. When the bottom shelf is fully loaded, it will have up to 13 buckets, probably weighing close to 130 pounds. Even though these shelves, I think, are rated at 300 pounds, most of the weight will be in the bottom, so there will be quite a bit of flex to it. So what I do is I take a few 2x4s and stick them underneath the bottom. So we have the 2x4s underneath there now. Whatever you use, you don't need a 2x4, and it doesn't even need to be touching the bottom of these bars. But do make sure that whatever you place under the bottom of the shelf is underneath these heavier support bars. I'm not stressing these standard bars because those are more likely to pop. But now with the 2x4 there, we can support much more weight. What we have here is a 1-inch rubber foot that did not come with the storage rack. The feet for the storage rack are plastic. I prefer to have these rubber feet. Between the bottom shelf and the middle shelf is 21 inches. Now between the center shelf and the upper shelf, it'll be 24 inches. And from the top shelf to the very top will also be 24 inches. And this top of the rack will be used for where we'll store all of our buckets. And this is what I use for lights. This is the Happy Leaf 33-inch Procyon series. I have purchased 14 Happy Leaf lights, 12 of the 33-inch models, one of the 17-inch models, and one of the 4-inch models. And with full disclosure, I have received 3 prototypes for testing, and I did not pay full price for those prototypes. But those prototypes were received before I discussed this video series with Vic at Happy Leaf. But regardless of whether I received the prototypes or not, I still use Happy Leaf LEDs. 48 watt nominal wattage, which is really low, has very good power ratings, and has a low heat output, doesn't need any fans or any auxiliary cooling. I have looked for other lights. I just can't find anything that has the low wattage and the light output that the Happy Leaf light does. They're not cheap, but they're not expensive either by what you get for your money. And as you can see right there, the light is made in the USA. The plugs, I believe, are made in China, but the light itself is made in the USA. So I'm a big fan of the Happy Leaf lights, and obviously do your own research, see what is available out there. But for my grow, I use Happy Leaf.
Before you go to hang your lights, have the eye bolts running along the length of the light. If it doesn't snug down so it runs along the length of it, don't torque it down and try to crack the case, even though there's some sort of metal there. Just loosen it a little bit. Okay, let's talk about light position. So to hang your Happy Leaf light, you can do it one of two ways. Either way you do it, you'll probably want to have some of these little S-hooks. I've purchased these from Amazon. I think I got 100 of them for $7. Or you can buy S-hooks from your local hardware store. Buying 100 is a lot cheaper per unit than buying them from the hardware store, but you probably only need 6. One thing I like to do with my S-hooks is cinch them down a little bit. So when your lights are hanging up, if you knock the rack, it'll be a little less likely that they'd come off. I haven't had the problem, but I'm just a little hyper paranoid because, you know, the lights cost quite a bit of money and that takes all of 3 seconds to do. So I would suggest crimp down your S-hooks a little bit and it'll help it hold in position. All right. And now I want to talk to you about position of the lights. So in the center of the shelf here, we have these 5 crossbars. I generally use the center crossbar as where I hang my lights. And I found with this particular model, and it seems that most 24 by 48 heavy duty shelving units are the same as far as dimensions and the layout. I find if you go in 9 spaces from each side, it perfectly centers your Happy Leaf light. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9th position, hang your S hook. And then we'll do that to the other side and put the light in position. As you see, we have the light in position now. And even if you shake the rack, it's on there nice and secure. Another option we have for hanging the lights with the S-hooks is we could take a piece of string, this is some 95 pound paracord, and a spring-loaded cord clip thing. So if you would like to closely manage your light height position, you can hang this string off the S-hook. And then whenever you come down to do the work in the garden, you can adjust the lights to your liking. I typically like to see the lights right around 9 inches above canopy. With a fixed light position, it's more of a set it and forget it, and I'm okay with that. But with this, you'll have a little bit more control. So if you are just growing one rack, then this is a pretty simple addition and it's not very time consuming at all. But as I said, the fixed light position works fine. This might give you a little bit better growth if you manage it a little bit more closely. So now we have the paracord clip and the paracord. You can use a shoelace, heavy string. These lights are not that heavy, maybe a few pounds at most. But when you want to adjust your light position, release and lower. So early in the grow, you might want to have the lights down an extra 4 or 5 inches, and then every few days you can just raise it up. For this video series, I'll use both a fixed position light for the top shelf, and I'll use the adjustable for the center shelf. The lower shelf can just stay fixed.
So during the grow, we'll go through and adjust as necessary, and we can see the difference in growth performance. This is the fan that I use. It's an 18-inch floor model. I keep it on low and I aim it somewhere between the center and the upper shelf. So you'll want to have some sort of air circulation in the room that you're doing your grow. Depending on your humidity, it will depend on how much airflow you want to have across your plants. If you're in a very low humidity environment, you probably don't want too much airflow directly across the plants. Higher humidity, you'll probably want a little bit more. So I have it on a timer. It kicks on about an hour before the lights come on. So the lights come on at 8 a.m. and then an hour after the lights go off, which is lights go off at 10 p.m. I bought it at a local hardware store. I think I paid around $20. If I were to get a new one, I'd probably get a 12-inch model because I think the 18 is just a little bit too much power for my room. It just needs enough to keep the air flowing. And yeah, it's a fan. I also use a humidity and temperature gauge in the basement. Generally in the winter time, the temperature will stay closer to 65, 66. In the summer, about what it is right now. And I like to see, if I can keep it at one temperature, I would like it at 68 with 50% humidity, but somewhere in the range of 64 degrees to 72 degrees works well, and somewhere between 45% humidity and 55% humidity is fine. So that's what I'm generally working with. These are the timers that I use. So this one has a battery built into it, so if there's a power failure, it won't lose the current time. You won't have your lights coming on at all sorts of wacky time. I have this programmed for on at 8 a.m., off at 10 p.m. And then I use this model for my fan, so if I do have a power failure, which we do have, I'll have to come down and adjust this, but this comes on at about 7 a.m. and off at about 11 p.m. This is a little bit cheaper model. If you can stand to spend a few extra dollars, I like this. I don't like the small display on it, but they both do the job. When looking for an outlet surge protector, find one that has the plugs so they face to the outside, not down in a row, because the Procyon series lights uses these really thick plugs, and if it went down the center, it wouldn't work out. So I use this trip light. I have two, actually one other model. Just find one that has at least three facing to the outside, and if you're just using one rack, that should work for you just fine. This is what she looks like all lit up. Now for the setup, we're on to drilling holes in bucket lids. If there's one step that I don't like, this is it. So for this video series, I will need 29 bucket lids drilled, 26 with a single hole, and then we will do 3 with a 5-hole pattern. So probably can't see it, but there's little raised pieces right there. Actually,
put some silver Sharpie on these. We'll erase spaces evenly divided by six. So this is the pattern that I'll be doing for five spots. When you drill the hole, you'll want to have at least a half inch away from the edge of this little lip right there. If not, your net cup will sit up at an angle. Not super critical. Don't freak out if that's what happens, but just want to let you know to have your hole be at least a half inch away from the side. So let's get started. So to drill holes in the buckets, you'll need a 1-inch hole saw. If you go to Amazon, type in 1-inch hole saw, you'll find some. I'll have some information about these in the show notes. Obviously, you'll need a drill. This is one that I had for about 3 or 4 years. I've just beat the snot out of it, but it works great. And since we're using a drill, of course, I want to see full safeties and some earplugs wouldn't hurt either. So, all right, make sure we have it in the right direction. Some people, when they drill their holes in their bucket lids, they'll drill down into it going forward, and then when they hit the plastic with the edge of the actual hole saw, they'll go in reverse. I see no benefit in doing that, but if that's what you want to do, I say go for it. So try to get it centered. There's a little nub there in the middle, so it won't be perfectly centered, but that's fine because we don't need super precision. All right, so we're on the edge there of the hole saw, and I just give it a few thrusts. There we go. And I do all this on top of a bucket, so I have a place for all my shavings, and I'll vacuum up the rest later. And there we go. So if you have a small sharp knife, you can get rid of all these little plastic edges, or maybe sand them down a little bit. Again, not super critical. It just makes it a little bit easier to wash if you get rid of all these little rough edges. Now on to our five-hole lid. So as I said, there are six positions that are evenly distributed, so I use those as my guides. So our 12 o'clock position right there, our 6 o'clock right there, and then we have 3 and 9, and one in the center. This is great content, eh? And our 12. Again, making sure that you keep the edge of the hole saw at least a half an inch away from the edge. Again, we don't need hyper precision. It's just nice to have them spaced out evenly. Go. I've had a little bit of practice. As I said, this is not my favorite portion of doing my grow operation by any stretch. But our neck kit fits in just fine, and it's not being lifted up on the edge, so we are in good shape. And now we just do this over and over and over again. So get all your bucket lids if you're going to grow this way. And get them drilled up, cleaned up a little bit, and soon we'll be on to our grow. Very excited.